Hello, my dear students. Hope you are all doing fine. So we are off with the carbon chapter, that is carbon chemistry. Only a very little portion was included this year. The rest all they deleted. That means the nomenclature or naming of the compound they deleted. So only till homologous series it was in the syllabus. But still. Today we are going to take a new chapter, that is the periodic classification of elements. But after covering this chapter, I will give you or I will teach you how to name a compound in an organic compound. Because without knowing how to name a compound in organic chemistry or a carbon compound, there is no use. That is what I think. So after this this chapter, that is this is the last chapter in chemistry. So after winding up this chapter, I will make sure that we will know how to write an organic compound. At least the main three or four rules we will discuss, and then you will be able to write at least a simple naming of an organic compound. Okay. So now we will move on to the next and the last chapter, that is the periodic classification of elements. Now one thing I want to tell you is, now the last chapter is going on. I want to see the notes till today, that is a carbon compound. Carbon compound, I think it is very, very little. But I think I haven't seen your acid bases and salts, no? So be prepared with that. I will tell you the date for which you have to send it. The exercise questions and also the in-text questions. The last year's question paper, I will give you separately, the question paper and questions. Okay. That will leave it. Apart from that, I know you are making the notes, that also I want to see, and also the question answers. So be prepared with the notes. Okay. Now coming to this periodic classification of elements. I think all are knowing about periodic table, at least. At least some of you will be familiar with the periodic table, but everybody must be knowing about some periodic table is there, or the classification of elements is there. So you have studied in smaller classes about molecules, elements, compounds, etc. And you mixtures, etc. And you already know that an element contains only one single type of atom, etc., etc. Now, in nature, 96 natural elements are there, and all together there are 118 elements. So 118. Elements are there altogether, and out of which this 96 are natural ones. The rest are artificially prepared. And even now the scientists are going and discovering new elements and giving their names, like in IUPAC. So in this chapter, what we have to learn is we are studying how this modern periodic table, what you call it as, how that comes into picture, or who made or who discovered that elements, and who made this periodic table easier for us, etc. And also at the same time, we are also going into the detail of this modern periodic table, which was set by Mendeleev, but also the earlier attempts. So many scientists have attempted to make this periodic table. So all that earlier attempts, or 3-4 earlier attempts, scientists also, we are going into detail. So we know that 118 elements are there till now, and out of this 96 are natural elements. But see, every year the scientists are discovering new elements. Okay, but the problem was how to occupy all these elements according to their properties, because they are working on these elements for their chemical property, physical property, etc. And they want to make all these elements in an arranged order. Otherwise, it is not easy for us to study these properties of these elements and make use of these elements. Like one example, or if an analogy was to say, if you want an analogy, first example, you have two shops. In one shop, like a professional store, all the things are not arranged. It's not arranged in a manner way. If you want and purchase 1 kilogram of sugar, the the shopkeeper will go around and see where the sugar is, and then he will take it out, the sugar, and then he weigh it out, then he will make it like tie it, put up and give it to us. But if we go to an arranged shop, now we will see in malls or in margin free things, they are all arranged, they all kept their things in orderly manner, isn't it? And there will be some notations for that. For example, in case of soap, if you want to buy a bathing soap or a washing soap, you go to that section, isn't it? Other than telling the shopkeeper, I want a Dove soap or a Pure soap, he will go around here and there and we don't know where it is. It will be in one corner. If you say another thing, as you want something else, he will go for the another corner. So it is a chaos. Chaos means it is not in an orderly manner. But if you go in a shop where everything is arranged, which of these is easier for you? Is it the not orderly one, or it will be the orderly one? Definitely it will be the orderly one, so that you can have a look at that and you can take it from there. So in the soaps, if I want to buy a soap, I will go to the soap section, and it is clearly written as the soap section, and there you will see so many kinds of soap out of which you can choose which soap you want, depending upon your skin, this thing, or your if you have allergy to some soap, you won't take that. You will take it of your own choice as a soap. Or if you want to try out some soap, you can either try out by seeing that, okay, this soap is new to the market, so shall I give a try? So like that. So if it is an orderly manner, you will very easily know what is there in the market, what are the new products, what do you want. So all this you can note it if they are well mannerly arranged. In the same way, if all these 119 elements are here and there, you will put somewhere some elements in there and some elements here. So there is no order in that elements, right? And we don't know which all elements will have the same property. Is there any elements having same property? See, all these questions are there. Okay, so for that reason, the scientist has decided to make all these elements to get order. That is why we say making order out of chaos. Chaos means unordered way. Okay, now how to make an order from this unordered way? That is means chaos. Okay, now we are going to study the early atoms, because at the first there were no 118 elements. When scientists was discovering the elements one by one, there are only very few elements, like 5 or 6. Then it gets on added and it comes to this number, isn't it? So we will see how in early times the scientist has made this order by their physical and chemical properties, and they make some order in that particular elements. For example, if only 15 elements were there, scientists made an attempt to make that 15 elements in special groups and join it and make a table. Okay. Now the first attempt, so many scientists have this several ideas were put up, but the recognized thing we will study two or three we will study here. Okay, so the successful one we are studying here. The first early attempts which was made by ordering these elements was Daubonier trial. Daubonier, the scientist called as Daubonier. Okay, now first we will see the Daubonier's theory, or how he attempted these elements to form a order. Okay, so it is called as a Daubonier trials. It was named as Daubonier trials. Okay. Daubonier triads. Why you call it as triads? Because he ordered the elements in three numbers. Tri means three numbers. Okay. So he chose all the elements and he attempted these elements. He studied the physical and chemical properties of these elements and tried to come out with an idea of ordering the elements. Now what Daubonier tried these elements, or he arranged the elements in the increasing order of atomic number. You know what is atomic number, right? What is atomic number, you know? Okay.
Okay, so every element has got an atomic number. Sorry, I'm very, very sorry, atomic mass. Okay, so he ordered the arrangements in the increasing order of the atomic weights or atomic mass. Then he found that three groups he made. Okay, he arranged these elements, whatever elements were there at present at that time, he made that elements into simple groups, and each group consists of three elements. That is why it is called as Daubonnier triad. Okay, now it contains three elements, and he made or he arranged the three elements in the increasing order of atomic weight. For example, he made a triad. He made a triad with sodium. What was the first group? Hydrogen, lithium, sodium, potassium. So he made the first triad as lithium, sodium, and potassium. See, there are only three elements. That is why he called it as Daubonnier triad. Three elements, and he formed these three elements in one group. See, in one group. This was his classification of elements. First classification, early classification. Daubonnier's time, there were only few elements were discovered. So, in that discovered elements, he made this conclusion. What he made? He arranged these elements into small groups, which are triads, which means only three elements are there. And he arranged it in the order of increasing atomic mass or atomic weight. That means lithium, then atomic number as atomic mass is increasing, sodium, and potassium is having more atomic mass. Okay. So he arranged the elements in the increasing order of their atomic mass or atomic weight, and he shows that, or he said that the middle element atomic mass, see, the atomic mass of the middle element is found to be the average of the first and the last element. See, that was his conclusion. So he was studying these elements, and what he did, he put three elements in one group. That is why it is called as a triad. And what then he did? He arranged these three in the increasing order of their atomic mass. And then he said that, or he concluded that, the middle element has an atomic number, I mean atomic mass, which is the average of these two elements. The atomic masses of these two elements. Okay, so we will see how it goes. You know, aluminium has got an atomic mass of 7. Okay, 7. And sodium has got an atomic mass of 23. Then potassium has an atomic number of 39. See, these are atomic masses. Okay, then he concluded the atomic mass of the middle element, is the average of these two masses of the first and the third element, which means that 7 plus 39 by 2 must be equal to in and around of this middle atomic mass. See, that means let us see 39 plus 7, that is 46 by 2, that is 23. See, so this was his conclusion. So Daubonnier triad says that, or he arranged the elements in triads. Triads means three elements in one group. And he says that he arranged these elements, the three elements, in increasing order of their atomic masses. And he says that the mass of the middle element will be the average of the sum of the average of these first and the third element. That was his Daubonnier theory for the classification. He made two more triads. See, one was lithium, sodium and potassium. Now you got it, right? How you got this? His conclusion, that is 23. The atomic weight or mass of this element is the sum of the first average of the first and the third element. That is 7 plus 39 by 2. Two elements. Now average. Average means how many elements? 2. So 7 plus 39 by 2. That is comes to be approximately 23. So that was his conclusion. Now he made two more triads like this. Two more triads. That is, one is lithium, sodium and potassium. Second is calcium, strontium and barium. This is also a triad in which he says that the atomic mass of strontium, listen, the atomic mass of strontium is, how you can be calculated, will be the sum of the masses, average of, the sum of the average of this masses of calcium and barium. He calculated. For example, you know calcium, you will try it out. Calcium is 40, okay, and barium is 137. Now what must be the strontium? Strontium must be 40 plus 137 by 2. So it will be comes around 87. So in that way it comes true. Okay, now he also find one more triad. He also found one more triad as chlorine, bromine and iodine. So these are the three triads which Daubigny was put up. That is lithium, sodium, potassium, calcium, strontium and barium and chlorine, bromine and iodine. So these were the three triads that is Daubigny put up in the classification of elements. But this theory failed or didn't give an approval for by the IUPAC as the classification. Because he only have three triads. But there were many more elements at that time. Now he couldn't explain his conclusion in all that elements. So this theory was a failure. Now why this theory was a failure? It was a failure because there are only three triads he found. Out of so many elements, only he made three triads of which his postulates were correct. Now what was his postulate or what was his theory? His theory states that, what was it? He arranged the three elements in the increasing order of their atomic number and he says that the atomic weight of the middle element will be the average sum of the atomic masses of the first and the third element. That comes true only in these three triads, that's all. Or he found only three triads or nine elements only he found this property. The rest he could not find. So this Daubigny triad of classification was a failure. So he couldn't get out along with this classification. Now what happened? Atomic masses comes into the picture. Because Daubigny tried out with atomic mass of that element. You know what is atomic mass, right? The mass of the atom which is concentrated in the nuclei. Isn't it? The mass of the proton as well as the neutron. That is a mass. Isn't it? Okay. So everyone, every other scientist then researched out into this atomic mass or atomic weight. They do their classificational research in accordance with the atomic masses. Then came a next scientist. So now you know what is Daubigny triads, isn't it? Daubigny theory of classification. It was a failure. Now comes again a scientist called as Newland. And Newland put in again another theory in order to classify the elements. Okay, so the other theory was an utter failure, but it was published in that time because at least he says that the atomic number was of importance to an element. So in that way it was published, but everybody knew that it was a failure because only some elements he was made the classification of triad, so they couldn't agree on that. Now then came another scientist which was called as Newland. What is it? Newland. It's a British scientist. The Daubnier was a French scientist, but this is called an English scientist, that is Newland. A scientist called as Newland formulated a theory which is called as Newland's law of octaves. What is it? Newland's law of octaves. This was the name of his theory. You know what is octaves? Which is, what is connected with this octaves? Music, isn't it? Music. There are octaves in music. So he connected, like Newland says that at the time of Newland, till thorium was discovered, till the element, that is atomic mass of 56 was discovered. So till thorium, he knew that there are elements starting from hydrogen to thorium. That is, he started arranging the elements in the increasing order of again atomic mass. Very, very important. First, all classification was based on atomic mass. So, Newland, what he did? He classified or he arranged. How many elements were then known? 56 elements were known. That is, from hydrogen to thorium. 56 elements were known, and he arranged all these elements in the increasing order of atomic weight. Okay, so first he put hydrogen, then there is a table in your book, just go through the table. First he put hydrogen, then comes the lithium, then beryllium, then boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, etc. He made a table. That is called as Newland's law of octave table. Now, what his law states that he arranged the elements in the order, increasing order of their atomic mass, and he found that every eighth element, remember, every eighth element will show the properties same as the first element. Got it? The law states, the Newland's law of octaves says that every eighth element will show the similar property as that of the first element. And he set an analogy like octaves. You know, in music, there octave means eight. Play eight. That means sa, re, ga, ma, pa, dha, ni, again sa. Isn't it? See, first sa, re, ga, ma, pa, dha, ni, sa. So, first is sa and eighth is sa. So, after eighth element, again it is coming back to what? The first element, the property. The properties are same for the first and the eighth element. Or, in a periodic table, as a classification, I will say, for example, if you say lithium, second group, lithium, beryllium, boron, carbon, nitrogen, oxygen, okay, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, fluorine, and then comes sodium, see, then magnesium, then aluminium. This was his table. Now listen, he says that after every eighth element, it shows the property of the first element. That means, see, if I count it from lithium, so this is 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7 and 8. See, it shows the same property, so he put this lithium sodium in one group. Okay, so Newland's law of octave says that every eighth element has got similar property as that of the first element. That was his Newland law of octaves. As similar in the case of musical notes. You know, musical notes, octave. So in the similar way, the first note and eighth note is same in musical octaves. So in the same way, every eighth element has got the same chemical property as that of the first element. And that is how he classified that classification. He has done his classification. That means every eighth element. If I start with beryllium, if it is the first one, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8. See, beryllium and magnesium both are in same group, or he put it in the same way, because its chemical properties are same. See, we want to classify the elements in terms of this property, chemical property, isn't it, or physical property. So he says that every eighth element has got the same chemical property as that of the first element. That was his law states. So what is Newland's law of octaves? Newland's law of octaves says that every eighth element has got similar chemical property, value point, similar chemical property as that of the first element. Similar in the case of musical notes or octaves. Now is this clear? No. So there were only 56 elements known, that is from hydrogen to thorium. Okay, thorium, the formula is TH, and he arranged all these elements in the increasing order of atomic mass. Correct? Clear? Okay. Now, if you examine the table, just go through the table in your textbook. Just go through the table in the textbook. You have seen two elements in the same group. See, you have, if I read it out, you have seen hydrogen, then fluorine, then chlorine, then comes cobalt and nickel. So there was some confusion in that table, isn't it? So there comes the drawback of this Newland octet, or the disadvantage of this Newland octet. Okay, so the law is like that, but the disadvantage of the theory is that the first disadvantage is, as he said, every eighth element is having the same chemical property as the first element. But that theory also is applicable only till calcium, or only till atomic number 20 on the 20th element, calcium. See? Again, there are many more elements. Now 56 elements were there. The rest 32 elements are not agreeing his law, which he introduce himself. So that was the first disadvantage or limitation of Newland's law of octet. That means it is the Newland, this law, the Newland law of octet is applicable only up to calcium, that is 20th element, calcium. The rest heavier elements, it is not holds good. That was the first limitation. Now, the second limitation is very funny. He thought that, Newland thought that, only 56 elements were discovered and later on there will be no discoveries in the elements. He assumed that nobody is going to find out the new elements. Okay, that was a foolish thing. So, the second limitation was, what he thought that only 56 elements were discovered, will be only there, and no more elements will be later discovered. That was his second drawback or second limitation, because after that 119 elements came. See, so that was the second limitation or second drawback. Now the third drawback is, there are three drawbacks or disadvantages. The third drawback is, as I have already told you, if you go through the table in the Newland octave, you can see in one group, he put two elements. In one group, for example, hydrogen, fluorine, chlorine, he also put the cobalt and nickel. See, hydrogen, fluorine, chlorine, nickel and cobalt. There were two elements he put in one slot. Okay, and that too, one more this thing is there, one more limitation, and that too, he put these two elements, nickel and cobalt, and these two elements has got no resemblance with the property of the other elements in that group. See, that was a very serious drawback. First of all, he increased, he arranged this elements from hydrogen 1 to thorium, 56 elements in the increasing order of the atomic mass. Then he put two elements in one slot, and that too, that elements has got more resemblance in the properties of the all other elements in the same group or the same slot. That means here hydrogen, fluorine, chlorine has got some similarity in the chemical properties, but there is no resemblance of this fluorine or chlorine with these two elements, nickel and cobalt. You know, nickel and cobalt are metals. Fluorine and chlorine are non-metals. So entirely they are having different chemical and physical property. So these are the three drawbacks of Newland's law of octave theory. So is it clear? So today, what you have studied? You have studied two theories. One is Daubonnier theory, or you call it as Daubonnier's triad. And second is Newland law of octaves. What you studied in Daubonnier triads? He made or classified the elements in triads, which means there are only three elements in one slot or one group. And what he said, the atomic, and he arranged the three elements in the increasing order of their atomic masses or atomic weight, both are same. And what he concluded was, the atomic mass of the middle element will be the average sum of the atomic masses of the first and the third element. But what was his limitation, his theory's limitation? His limitation was, he could find only three triads. That is, what was it? That is chlorine, bromine, iodine, calcium, strontium, barium, lithium, sodium and potassium. So he could found only the three triads, and all other elements he cannot put his hypothesis there. That means the average sum will not be the middle atomic mass. So that theory was a failure. Now comes what? The Newland law of octaves. Now Newland octave, in that case there were 56 elements were there at that time. That is starting from hydrogen and ending in thorium. The 56th element is thorium. Correct? Now what he did? He also arranged all these 56 elements in the order of increasing atomic weight or atomic mass. Then he made a law which is called as Newland law of octaves. Octave means somewhat something related to the musical notes. Octave, 8 notes are there. And now what his law states? His law states that every 8th element will show same chemical property, the value point underline. Every 8th element will show the same chemical property as that of the first element. In the same way as you can see in the musical notes like sa, re, ga, ma, pa, dha, ni, again sa. So first is sa and 8th is sa. So same chemical property. In that way, same musical note. In that way, the first and the 8th element will have the same chemical property. And according to that law, he placed the elements in the classification of elements in that way. But that was also a failure. Now, what was his failure or what was his limitation? The first limitation was, he made a law that every 8th element will have the property of the first element. But that law holds good only till calcium or 20 in number. Atomic number is 20. So till calcium, that is for lighter elements only, it is valid or it is true. For heavier elements, it doesn't hold good or it is not
getting it, if the law is not valid for heavier elements till thorium. It is only applicable till calcium. So that was his first disadvantage. What was the second disadvantage? He thought that, or he assumed that, only 56 elements will be there and no more new elements will be discovered after. That was not true. So that was his second failure, isn't it? Now what was his last failure or last disadvantage? He put more than one element, see? He put more than one element in the same slot, and that too, it is having no resemblance in chemical property with the other elements he put in that slot. So that was his third limitation. So what happened at last? Moral of the story? His Newland law of octave theory is also not valid. So it does not make into this classification level. But we have to study all these early attempts. Then only we will have a mood or hang of how this scientist comes up with more and more theories and put forward the last periodic table. Okay, so these two laws will make it. Okay, go through the textbook, read the textbook. Next session, we will see the another scientist who named as Mendeleev and what was his theory on the classification of these elements. So, till now, read the text. Any doubt, just give a call. Till then, thank you.